rejoice and be glad in it continuously. We will praise you. Father, we thank you for being such a great God, a merciful God, an awesome God. We thank you for new beginnings, new life, God. Father, we thank you for your blood that covers and cleanses us from all unrighteousness, Father. We thank you, God, for open doors even today. God, we thank you for promotion. God, we thank you for, God, keeping our mind and our hearts today, God. Some of us had a bad day today and some things happened at work, God, but we thank you for rectifying everything that's not like you, God. We thank you that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. Father, I thank you that we're the head and not the tail. We're above only and not beneath. God, no weapon, anything that people, man may try to say against what you've already said about us, we don't receive it. And we trust your word. We trust what you said about us, God. We trust that you said we are the head and not the tail. We are your sons. We are rulers and we're reigning and ruling right along with you. And God, we thank you for that. We give you glory for us ruling and reigning. And Jesus, we love you. How many want to love on Jesus? Because we rule and reign with him. We rule and reign with him. That's a good thing to just understand, that we rule and reign with him. Our God reigns. But Lord, you're mighty. You're awesome. You're awesome. You're awesome. Lord, you're awesome. Come on. Because he's an awesome God. Hey, he's an awesome God. And we love to worship and adore you, Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into your house tonight. Into your house tonight. We bring the sacrifice of praise, Lord, Lord, you are awesome, Lord, you are awesome. Can you help me sing it again?
If it wasn't for your grace,
if you would just wave your hands, wave your cares away to an awesome God. Yeah, God, I want to wave my cares away because I trust you with everything. I trust you with my family, trust you with my job. I know you can do all things. Nothing is impossible for you, Jesus. Nothing, nowhere is impossible for your love. You are awesome. We just had to stay there for a minute because there's somebody in here that's a little discouraged because what you wanted to see happen and how God, you thought God was going to manifest and change that situation. He's not changing the situation. He's changing you in the situation. He's not changing the situation. He's changing you in the situation. And an awesome God understands how to do, what to do, when to do, because he's omnipresent. He's all powerful. He's all knowing. He knows what's on the inside of you, yeah. He knows what's on the inside of you. He knows what's on the inside, what's on the inside. So he's trying to pull the inside out. He knows what's on the inside. He knows what's on the inside. Jesus, Jesus, he's mighty. He's mighty. So great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in my lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise to you. I know, God, we may not understand it, but God, we pour out our praise and we bring the sacrifice of praise into this house and we create an atmosphere for you to habitate, for you to live in. For you to live in, God. We say live in our praise. We say live in our worship. We say abide in it. Abide, 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 abide. Abide in our worship, Jesus.
You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope.
You give.
You restore,
you restore
every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord.
Jesus,
great are you, Lord.
Help us sing.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore,
you restore
every heart that is broken. Great.
Great are you. this part. Say,
all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
Can everybody sing that with us? Come on, say,
all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
One more time. All the earth will sing.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you.
Pour out your praise tonight. It's your breath, Jesus, in our lungs, Jesus. So we
pour out our praise to you.
One more time, it's your breath in our lungs.
So we pour out our praise.
Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we.
Hallelujah.
Great are you, Lord.
Last time, great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord.
Father, we thank you right now, Lord, for your presence in this place, God. We honor you for your spirit having its way in this house on tonight, God. We come right now just casting down every weight, every care, every burden, Father God. Every assignment that the enemy had against us, God, we cancel it right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, we put you in your rightful place, which is at the head of everything we know, Father. We give way to your spirit in this place, God. Cover us with your grace, with your anointing, with your favor, God. Set this place on fire tonight, God, that we shall not leave here the same way, God. But as the word comes forth, God, we shall be changed, Father. Our mind shall change, our heart shall change, and as a result, our lifestyle shall change, God. So visit us on tonight. Touch these, your people, Father God. Touch these ministers that are coming to bring the word of God with power and with conviction, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you.
Amen. Amen. Well, good evening, Agape family. How y'all doing tonight? Come on, let's put your hands together tonight. It's a good night. It's a great night. Before you be seated, go ahead and hug somebody. Put wrap your arms around the neck. Tell them it's good to see them again. Just tell somebody it's good to see your face in the place. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, how many of y'all excited about the four flames going on tonight? Amen. I know I'm excited. I got some powerful ministers coming up to bring the word of God tonight. I'm excited about what's about to happen in here. If you're not coming expecting a word from God, there's the door, because it's coming forth tonight. Amen. We definitely give honor to our shepherd, Pastor Maurice, in his absence. Our co-pastor, Pastor Katiti, is in the building here tonight, so we definitely honor them for tonight. As we've told the ministers before they come up, you know, they may not come up and go through all the accolades that you guys are accustomed to, giving honor to God and everybody else and all of them too. You know, we just gonna bless you. And then they going right into the word today. Amen. Amen. So I'm going to read off who's coming up tonight, and then they're going to come up in that order. I'm not coming back up in between each one. We're just going to hear from the Lord tonight through these men and women of God. So we do have Minister Richard Leach. He's hitting up first, followed by Minister Leach is Minister Joyce Matthews. After that will be Minister Rick Marshall. And bringing it home is Minister Manisa Mullins. Amen. So at this time, if you would receive the man of God, Minister Richard Leach.
Hello. Amen. All right. How's everyone doing tonight? Amen. Praise the Lord. I just got to give God the praise for being here. We got to do that and praise God for this awesome pastor of ours, Pastor Maurice and Katiti Revelle. Amen. Come on, let's give it up for them. And all the great ministers in this house. This is a great house. I say it all the time, every time I get an opportunity. And also, I want to give a shout out to my lovely wife who was under the weather tonight, but she still pressed her way. And my son, Christopher, amen. Thank you guys for coming out tonight. Let's get into the word, amen. I'll be coming from Isaiah chapter 48, verse 17. And it reads, "This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. He says, I am the Lord your God, who teaches you what is best for you, who directs you in the way you should go." And I want to use for a subject very quickly, suspicion of God. Suspicion of God. In Matthew chapter 19, verses 16 through 22, we find the story of the rich young ruler. And this rich young ruler, he came to Jesus with some spiritually sensitive questions. And the gist of his questions, he wanted to know one thing. And he wanted to know, how can I be right with God? Has anybody got to that point in your life yet where you just want to be right with God? I mean, outside of popular opinion, outside of your success, and I'm going to say this right here, this might mess up your theology a little bit, even outside of your salvation. Because, see, you can be saved and still not be right with God. Amen. So even outside of your salvation, I think about that old song from Keith Wonder, Bud Johnson. He said, "I just want to be right." Anybody remember that song? He said, "When you see me singing, when you see me shouting," he said, "whatever you see me doing," he said, "I just want to be right." And I believe that's what Keith Wonder, Bud Johnson was talking about. He wanted to be right with God. Even though he was saved, sanctified, filled with the Spirit, he still wanted to be right. And so I just want to read that Matthew real quick. I'm going to go through it real quick. I don't want to read all of it for the sake of time, but I'm going to start at verse 17. Well, first of all, he asked the question. Jesus, he said, "What good things must I do to get eternal life?" Verse 17 in the C clause, it says, "If you want to enter life, obey the commandments. Which ones the man required? Jesus replied, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, honor your father and your mother, and love your neighbor as yourself. Now, I want to stop right there for a minute because it almost seems like Jesus is saying in order to be right, you have to keep the commandments or you have to be right by works. But you know we're dealing with Jesus and he knows all things, right? He's the beginning and the end. He's the Alpha and the Omega. So he knew this man. He knew all about this man. He knew that this man was young. He knew that he was rich. And he knew that he was a ruler, probably a ruler of the synagogue, which was a religious group. And they touted themselves by keeping the commandments. Matter of fact, they would add some commandments to the commandments. Amen. That's how religious they were. But that's not what Jesus was saying. Jesus was saying outside of obedience, he was saying the only way that we can be right is in our hearts. You know, we have to be right in our hearts. Some things have to line up. I guess the old folks used to say it like this. They say what's on the inside shows up on the outside. And so that's what Jesus was saying to this man. Matter of fact, in verse 18, it says, Matthew 7 and 18, it talks about a tree. It says that a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and that a bad tree couldn't bear good fruit. But it says that you know a tree by the fruit that it bears. Amen. So that's what we got to deal with, how Jesus was dealing with this man and how he was dealing with the situation and the things that was taking place. So Jesus has a way, just to move forward, of kind of putting his hand on our problem. Because read verse 21. Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, he says, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me, he says. But when the man heard this, he went away sad because he had to give up his wealth. So this man didn't want to give up his possessions. He didn't want to give up the things that he had. One of the things that he had, just kind of deep, one thing he had to give up was his wealth. He had to give up his money. He had to give up his possessions. Amen. Y'all like how deep I was right there? Not only that, he'd had to give up his idols. He'd had to give up his, you know, we think about our idols, our houses, our cars, all these things we had to give up. And this man, I guess he wasn't willing to give these things up, which brought about a suspicion. I guess he was suspicious of God. So underlining his refusal to accept the call of Jesus brought about a position that perhaps God didn't have his best interests at heart. So this man became suspicious of Jesus. Let me define that word suspicious. Suspicious is a belief or feeling that someone has done something wrong to you. You know, when you're suspicious of somebody, you kind of look at them sideways. You know what I mean? You kind of have a side look of them. You're wondering what they're talking about. So has anybody ever been suspicious of God? When I talk about being suspicious, I'm talking about when you pray to God about something and then he gives you an answer and then that's not the answer you wanted from him. You become suspicious of God when you do that. So we're not really following his rules and his regulations. So how do we get to that point? And I'm going to give you 3 points real quick and I'll be out of the way. The first point is when obedience contradicts the leanings of our heart. When obedience contradicts the leanings of our heart. See, because sometimes God will tell us some things to do that we find a little difficulty doing them. You know, he'll tell us things to do and our heart find it hard to write a check for those things. Amen. Like he might tell you to love your neighbor, but you may not want to love your neighbor. Some things you may want to do. You know, it's things that God tells us. And so I guess we find ourselves in a state of suspicion of God. Amen. Number two is when we find it difficult to conform to the will of God. Now, what is the will of God? I had to look up some scriptures. I looked up in John chapter 4, verse 34, where Jesus said that his food or his meat was to do the will of God. Not only that, in Luke chapter 22, verses 42, he said, this was Jesus talking to the Father. He said, Father, if it be your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. So when you think about the will of God, it's going to be sometime that God is going to tell us to do some things that's lined up with his will, but we may not want to do them. And we don't want to do those things. That's when we become suspicious of God. Amen. Come on, now, it ain't just me in here that been suspicious. So in Isaiah chapter 47, and I just want to hit that briefly. This is where Isaiah, one of the greatest prophets in the Old Testament, He was speaking to the children of Israel. Matter of fact, he was talking to the tribe of Judah. And he was just letting them know that God was their God. And that they didn't have to, you know, because I guess at that time they had got kind of comfortable. You know, sometimes we can get comfortable out in where we are because they had been moved out of exile. They had been redeemed. They had went back to Jerusalem. So they had just got comfortable in their places. You know, sometimes we can get comfortable in our houses and our homes and all the things we have to the point that we don't obey God and what he's calling us to do. Amen. And so I'm going to close right here. In 1974, Muhammad Ali fought George Foreman. And most people thought that Muhammad Ali was going to lose this fight. And the reason they felt like that, because George was 25, Muhammad Ali was 32 on a comeback. George Foreman he was undefeated. He was 40-0, 37 knockouts. And then he was a heavy puncher. And also a lot of people thought he was crazy. George had about 7 sons, and he named all of them George. That's kind of crazy, isn't it? But see, Muhammad Ali, he had a strategy. He had studied George, and he realized that he had never fought over a certain amount of rounds. And so his strategy was called the rope-a-dope. And that's where he kind of leaned back on the ropes for about 7 rounds, and he took all these big heavy punches from George Foreman. And so he knew about in that 8th round that George would run out of gas. And that's when Muhammad Ali knocked him out. Amen. He knocked him out in the 8th round, just like he thought. So what am I saying? God has studied you. He knows you. He has a plan for your life. And so when you seek him out, all you got to do is seek God. And when he gives you that plan that he has for your life, go ahead and follow it, because he has your best interest at heart. Amen.
Amen, amen. First, giving honor to God, who is the author and the finisher of my faith, to Pastor Maurice and Pastor Katiti Reveal, thank you. Thank you for taking the chance on developing me into the things of God. And in my husband's absence, I just want to just thank him also. I'm not going to be before you long. I'm just going to share with you what I have been receiving in prayer. I am a woman of prayer. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to read this quote from the man of God, one sermon that he preached on, and this really stood out to me. So I'm going to quote this. It say, to thy own self be true. We are not true to our, when we are not true to ourselves, we cannot operate in our gift or our assignment. Stop running from the assignment that God has called you to do. So I stand before you tonight, being obedient, doing what God has told me to do on tonight. And so in my time of prayer, God has been really dealing with me on repentance. Repentance and coming before God with clean hands and a pure heart. If you would turn to Matthew chapter number 10. And in chapter number 10, it's about the disciples, Jesus sending the disciples out. But what I want to read is just verse number 38. It say, and he who does not take up his cross and follow me, cleave steadfastly to me, conforming wholly to my examples in living, and if need be in dying, also is not worthy of me. And if you will go to Matthew 16 and verse number 24. It say, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to be my disciples, let him deny himself, disregard, lose sight of, and forget himself in his own interests, and take up his cross and follow me, cleaving steadfastly to me, conforming wholly to my examples in living, and if need be, in dying also. And I was reading those two verses out of the Amplified. And what really stood out to me in those two verses was the word cleave. And to cleave means to, it has a double meaning. It means to adhere firmly, closely, or to have loyalty, unwavering, to cling to a person or thing. It also means to be clingy, to hold on to something or someone very tightly. It also means to adhere. It means to stick to something, someone firmly, to give support, to maintain loyalty, to stick like glue, to bond. And the other meaning for cleave, it means to cut. It means to divide. It means to cause two or more people or things to stop being together, joined or connected, which means to be separated. And so on tonight, I come before you and I just ask you that you would begin to just cleave unto the things of God, that you would just stick to the things that God is telling you to do. If I could use for a theme or a topic tonight, it would be, what are you cleaving on to that you should be leaving? What are you leaving that you should be clinging on to? So if we would really just examine ourselves on tonight, we're cleaving on to unforgiveness. And God has told us to walk into forgiveness. And the first time that cleave is mentioned in the Bible, it is in Genesis. And it's in Genesis chapter 2, verse number 24. It says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and his mother and should become united and cleave together, cleave to his wife, and they should become one flesh. That's Genesis chapter 2, verse number 24. And that's what God wants us to be. He wants us to be one with him. He wants us to stick to what he tells us to do and don't let anything separate us from doing what God is telling us to do. So many times we think it's all about us, and it's not about us. I mean, I was like, okay, Lord, what would you have me to say to your people? I mean, I had notes here, there. No, it's in you. What have I been saying? We need to repent. We need to ask God to forgive us, to get in order, get things in order. The word of God, 1 John 1:9 say, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So once we take that step, just admit we have done things wrong. Just admit, get things in order, and get in line. And he said he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And it was probably in September that I had been in prayer, and that's when God was really just talking about how it's so much going on now in the world. It's just like, wow. It's like, okay, people need to get their lives in order. You know, stop just living and doing your own thing. It's not about us. It's about the kingdom. And we need to be obedient and do whatever God is telling us to do. And so in September, I was just praying and asking God, you know, just interceding for the people. And he began to say, the last quarter. I say, the last quarter? Okay, that's October, November, December. And in the last quarter, we had 92 days left. 92 days. It wasn't 90 days. It was 92 days. And so God was saying, you know, we need to get things in order. And I was like, okay, Lord, I hear you. And I just began to intercede. People, he would show me faces and things, and I would just begin to pray for them. And so I was like, wow, you know, we really need to get it together. We don't have time to be fooling around. We need to be doing what God is telling us to do. And so I was, I shared with Minister Teresa what the Lord had gave me. And so that Sunday we came to church, it was September the 11th. And, you know, Pastor just got off the series about multipliers. And he showed this clip of this little, I think it was a bamboo, thank you. A bamboo and how it started off and then how it grows in 90 days, how fast it grows within those 90 days. And so I was like, okay, God, I hear you. I hear what you're saying. So me personally, I'm coming to you on tonight, and I'm asking you, we have 80 days left, that you would begin to cleave to the things of God like never before. It's some things in your life that you need to cut away, and there's some things in your life that you need to stick to like never before. So on tonight, like I say, we have 80 days left. 80 days left. God wants us to begin to mature and grow in the things of him. We are his disciples. It's not about us. It's about the kingdom. So we need to set aside our agenda and find out what his agenda is, that we might go forth for the kingdom of God. And so within these next 80 days, just begin to examine yourself. I mean, I was like, okay, Lord, I hear you. Each Sunday we would come, Pastor, here we go again. He said, lay aside every weight. He began to talk about weights. He said it wasn't a sin, it was weights, it was habits that we needed to, you know, give up. So these next 80 days, let us begin to take a closer look at our walk with the Father and begin to cleave. Let us begin to stick to him, to his word like never before, and do what he is calling us to do in these days that we're in now. And so on tonight, I just bless you and I just challenge you to be obedient, to do what God is telling you to do. Do what he's telling you to do. Walk in don't walk in unforgiveness. Walk in forgiveness. Walk in love. Be obedient to the word of God. And that's when we humble ourselves, because we're obedient to what God is telling us to do. So my prayer that we all grow in the grace and the knowledge of the Father like never before. And let us continue to cleave to the things of God and leave those things that are not of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. God bless you.
Amen. Amen. Somebody with a white Sonata, license plate number JJC999. Your lights is flashing on your car. White Sonata, license plate number JJC999. Lights are flashing on your car. First, giving God the highest praises. To the pastors of this great church, Pastor Mo and Pastor Katiti Revelle, I want to thank them for giving me an opportunity to stand before you tonight. And to my lovely wife, who always has my back, no matter what. Amen. Even if I'm right, even if I'm wrong, she still got my back. If it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, where would I be? Let us pray. Father God, we ask that you take us out of self. Use us as a willing vessel. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in thy sight, O Lord and our Redeemer. Let us say amen. Our scripture tonight is coming from Daniel's third chapter. And the third chapter, beginning at the 12th verse. And it reads as follows. There are certain Jews whom thou hast set over the affairs of the providence of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. These men, O king, have not regarded thee. Do that sound like some of us? They serve not thy gods, nor the golden image which thou hast set up. So that sounds like somebody telling on somebody, right? That you ain't doing something that somebody asked you to do. Then Nebuchadnezzar, in his rage and fury, command to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then they brought these men. Then they brought these men before the king. Nebuchadnezzar spake and said unto them, is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Do not you serve my gods, nor worship the golden image in which I have set up? Now if ye be ready, that at what time you hear the sound of the cornets, the flute, the harp, the sackbut, the psaltery, dulcimer, and all kinds of music, you fall down and worship the image in which I had made well. But if you worship not, you shall be cast some hour into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. And who is that God that shall deliver you out of my hands? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered, said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of thine hands, O king. But if not be known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods, nor worship a golden image which you had set up. Then Nebuchadnezzar, full of fury and form of his visage, was changed against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Therefore he spake and commanded that they should heat the furnace seven times more than it was to be heated. And he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, to cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Then these men were bound in their coats, hosen, and their hats, and their other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore the king's commandment was urgent. The furnace is exceedingly hot. The flame of the fire slew those men that took them up. So what he was saying here is that don't worry about your enemy. Before your enemy can do anything to you, he better dig a ditch for himself. Because when they got ready to throw Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, the word say that they was consumed first. And these men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king astonished and rose up haste and spake and said unto his counselors, did we cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said unto the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see four men loose. They have no hurt. And the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. Then Nebuchadnezzar came near the mouth of the burning fiery furnace and spake and said, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you servants of the Most High God, come forth and come hither. Then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came forth of the midst of the fire. And all the princes, governors, and captains, and kings' counselors began to gather around because they couldn't believe what they saw. Upon whose bodies the fire had no power, nor was a hair on their head sign, nor were their coats changed, nor the smell of fire had passed on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar spoke and said, blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who have sent his angel to deliver his servant that trusts in him. The king's word, and yield their bodies, that they might not serve nor worship any god except their own. I tell you, oof, that just tore me up. That just tore me up. If I can tonight, I want to use for a subject or a text, if I can. I need somebody to say, look at me now. Look at me now. Look to your person to your right and tell them to look at you now. Then turn to your left and tell them to look at me now. Thank you. what I want to do tonight, since everybody already know the story, I want to try and paint a picture tonight using today's terms, thrown under the bus. I hear a lot of folks say today, men try to throw me under the bus. Don't push me, I'm already close to the edge. Yeah, I used to hear people say a lot today, man, don't you know they tried to throw me under the bus? And then I say, is it because you didn't do what they wanted you to do? Or you didn't say what they wanted you to say? Can I get a witness? Well, the same thing happened in the story with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, where Nebuchadnezzar threw them in a burning fiery furnace because they wouldn't do what he wanted them to do. I believe he knew of their faith and their strong belief. The God that they served, but wanted to test them to see if they would bow down to worship the idol that he has made. A lot of times we have from neighbors and our friends and everybody, they'll try to test us just to see where we at in God. But tonight, I want to let you know that's the way people are today. They want to test you just to see who you say you are. So if you don't stand up for something, you will fall for anything. PP, are you with me? When the pastor would say, give your neighbor a high five, if they only knew how we used to be, toe up from the floor up, they probably wouldn't want to sit beside us. But look at me now. When we meet people we hadn't seen in a while, we tell them the good news about how Jesus has changed our lives. The first thing comes out of their mouth. Man or girl, I remember when we used to do this, and I remember when we used to do that. But don't have the unction to say, well, praise the Lord. But look at me now. The same God that delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that from the burning fiery furnace, it's the same God that will heal, deliver, and set free right now today. So look at me now. I need about two or three people to go with me down memory lane. He had brought me from a mighty long way. We already know where we used to be. At this point, we're between a then and a now. A flip of the wrong switch. And we are back where we started from. When people had put us on an expiration date. Told us a saying that we ain't going to amount to anything. When you see them, just tell them, just look at me now. When we used to party all night Friday and Saturday night and sleep all day on Sunday. Now we're hanging around for both services on Sunday. Just look at me now. When we didn't pray for ourselves, but now we find ourselves praying for somebody else. Now we're in a prayer of agreement for somebody else. Just look at me now. We walk around talking about what he did, but he already done it. Look at me now. Remember when some of us used to blow more smoke than chicken charn? Can I get a witness? But now can't stand the smell of smoke. Just look at me now. Some of us used to raise more hell than an alley cat. But look at us now. We're singing songs of Zion. Let's look at me now. When our so-called friends turn their backs on us just because we didn't have a pot to pee in or one of them to throw it out of. Just look at me now. But look what God has did. A brick house on the hill. Three kids, two dogs, one cat, and a white picket fence. Just look at me now. Matter of fact, pull out your cell phones. Take a selfie of yourself and send it to somebody and just tell them to look at me now. Oh, Lord. Yeah, oh, Lord. They're trying to throw you under the bus. Just tell them to look at me now. But you know what I think so good about this message? I say amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Everybody say, look at me now. Look at me now. When you tried to put me down, didn't want to have nothing to do with me, but I was still leaning and depending on God. Amen, amen. In my closing tonight, I like to say, everybody has a story to tell. Everybody got a story to tell. I can't tell yours like you can. And you can't tell mine like I can. But I tell you this, God will deliver on time.
Somebody shout glory! Hallelujah! God is good, isn't he? I'm sitting there listening to Minister Rick, and I'm thinking about that time when I was deciding if I was going to cut my wrist or I was going to take pills, but look at me now. Hey! Should have took me out when you had the chance, because now I got the microphone, and I'm going to speak the word of the Lord. Amen? Amen. Praise God. I want to thank our pastors, Pastor Maurice and Katiti Revelle. They truly are two of the most greatest people on the planet. I thank you that you don't have to be qualified, so to speak, to get up here and be a wonderful orator. You just have to be willing. I thank you that they see gifts in us that sometimes we don't even see in ourselves. So I thank you, Pastor Maurice and Pastor Katita Revelle, for just being awesome servants of God. I want to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who truly is the best decision that I've ever made in my life. He has turned my life around and continues to do so on a daily basis. I want to thank my husband, who truly exhibits agape love. Pastor says agape is, in spite of what I know about you, I choose to love you anyway. So I'm thankful to God for that. Amen. How's everybody doing tonight? Good. Awesome. Every time I'm given an opportunity to speak, I try to do two things. And the first thing is I want to be transparent in my message. And the second thing is I want to encourage and motivate someone to change the course of their life to a better place. So, of course, since ministry starts at home, then the first thing I have to ask myself is, what am I not being transparent about in my life? And what area of my life do I need to encourage and motivate myself? So I'm sure you all know by now that everything that happens in your life is never just about you and what you're going through. Your challenges, your trials are always lessons that you can use to help someone else. So if you would join me tonight on my journey, and let's just see where it leads us, okay? Well, for the last 2 years of my life, I've been on a train that's been moving 100 miles per hour, but it just doesn't seem to be going anywhere. My life literally appears to be moving so fast, and I'm running sprints just to try to keep up with it. From the time my feet hit the floor in the morning until the time I lay my head on my pillow at night, it feels as if I'm just tied to a rope and I'm just being pulled in so many different directions. Some of you feel like that, I'm sure. Being a wife, a mother, a behavior analyst at work, a life coach, a minister, a motivational speaker, chair of this committee and head of that committee. I am currently completing 1,500
hours of internship after grad school that keeps me away from my home three nights a week until 8 o'clock at night. So when I leave the house at 6 o'clock in the morning, I don't get back until 8 o'clock that night. So my internship is in Charlotte, so it's 30 miles away from where I live in Rock Hill. So you would think on my way home, that would be a good time to kind of wind down, you know, think about the day, wrap my head around what's coming up next. And indeed, that would be a good time. But the problem is, instead of me thinking about where I'm going next, I'm asleep at the stoplight, and the car behind me is blowing the horn to alert me that I need to move forward. But by the grace of God, every night I make it home, I pull into the driveway, I open the door, hug and kiss my husband, hug and kiss my children, take that rope off, get 4 or 5 hours of sleep, wake up the next day, and do it again. So now I'm not telling you guys this because I want your sympathy or I want your compassion, because I'm sure anybody in this room could get up here and hold this mic. You could share an equal story or even worse. But I want to tell you that because I want to invite you into my world. So as a believer, we know that no matter what is happening in our life, it's just a season, that we're not going to always be there, right? But there are some seasons that we find ourselves in life, and even though we are human beings, we feel like we're human doings. We're just doing so much. We want to have a higher standard than other people. We want to be excellent in what we do. But the reality is that there are times in our life that what we're doing, we feel like we're not making any progress, like we're not being successful. We feel tired, we feel burned out, we feel overwhelmed. And even though we're moving, it appears that we're just standing in one place. And if we're not careful, we can tell ourselves that we're failures. The big F word. So when we leave tonight, I want us all to see that one of the best things that you could ever do in your life is fail. So you're looking at me like, what? Now, Pastor often says, just trust me, I'm going somewhere with this. So tonight's topic is how to become a big failure. So there's a spiritual principle that states that whatever you resist will persist. So whatever you're trying to stop from happening in your life, you are actually attracting so much energy that it's actually already happening. So if you're trying not to fail, you're actually already in the process of failing because of the energy that you're focusing towards not failing. Now, as a behavior analyst, I know that there are two reasons why we engage in any behavior. We're either trying to get something or we're trying to escape or avoid something. So let me ask you this. If you are getting up and going to work every morning, are you being motivated to get up to go to work because you're trying to get a paycheck, or are you trying to escape or avoid poverty? If you are health conscious, do you eat healthy and work out because you're trying to get a lean body, or you're trying to escape or avoid high blood pressure or diabetes? If you are a believer, do you go to church on a regular basis and pray without ceasing and tithe faithfully because you're motivated to get into heaven, or you're trying to escape or avoid hell? So now to bring it home. For anyone that's in this room that has ever fallen, made a mistake, lost everything, got a divorce, lived in your car, ate ramen noodles for 3 meals a day, stole food to survive, lied and was caught in your lie, cheated, had a drug or alcohol addiction, had a baby out of wedlock, you fill in the blank, whatever it is. Whatever your story is, just as Minister Rick said, we all have one. If you fail, why didn't you get back up again? Those are the people that I'm talking to, the people who feel like they've fallen in their life, but they just can't get back up. See, when you're reaching for, something that you dreamed of, but you thought it was just too big of a dream, so you just let it go. You thought, you know, I want to qualify for the $400,000 home when all your life you were living in the projects. And you shared that dream with someone, and someone said, people don't dream like that where we come from. You should just be glad if you can get an apartment. Did you want a nice car, but someone told you, you know, There's no way you'll be able to afford that with your income. Were you married and divorced three times and someone told you you'll never get married again? No one will want you. See, the Bible says in Romans 11:29, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. And irrevocable means it can't be changed. It can't be reversed. It can't be recovered. It is final. The Amplified Version says, for God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. He never withdraws them once they are given. And he does not change his mind about those to whom he gives his grace or to whom he sends his call. See, I've been living on the earth for 46 years, and there's one thing that I know for sure. And that is, if you are living and breathing, you will experience challenges, setbacks, disappointments, and even failure. See, to be honest with you, if you are a believer, there's really no such thing as failure, because failure actually means that you have given up. See, failure is not determined by your negative outcome. It's determined by your negative mindset. If you believe that you have failed, then indeed you have. Because, see, as a believer, we don't fail. We just win or we learn. We keep going. As long as you continue to try, you are in the game. See, it doesn't matter how you fall. What matters is how you get back up. See, as believers, in becoming a failure, the first thing you have to do is try something. If you're not trying something, then you can't even fail because you haven't even started. You haven't even taken the first step. Have you started a new career, a new relationship, a new business opportunity, a new color to paint your walls? It doesn't matter what the what is. You just have to be bold and brave enough to venture out there and do it. See, just recently I published my first book, and it was actually written in 2009, but it took me 6 years to get it published because I was afraid of what people would think of me once they read the contents of the book. So I was having this conversation with the Lord one night, and the Lord said, is it more important to you to concentrate on the hundreds of people that may criticize the book or the one person that says, your book changed my life? So then I decided it was worth it, and I published the book and released it this year. So instead of escaping or avoiding criticism, I got busy about getting an opportunity to save a life. See, the Bible gives us a wonderful illustration of someone that had fallen in their life and could very well be considered a failure. He had a terrible past. He sinned. He betrayed his family's confidence. He relinquished his spiritual gifts. He couldn't speak well. He had anger issues. Some of y'all saying, that sounds just like my cousin Johnny. But however, in spite of all these personal flaws, God used Moses to deliver his people out of Egypt. See, Moses thought he was becoming a failure, but he was actually becoming a big leader. There are many stories in the Bible where God uses people that don't seem qualified for the position to complete his plan. People like David, Joseph, Job, Jonah, Peter. See, the Bible says that God's ways are not our ways and his thoughts are not our thoughts. God can use anyone and anything to demonstrate his awesome plan for our lives. You don't need to concern yourself with what the plan is. Just trust and believe that there is a plan. Because in Jeremiah 29:11, it says, for I know the thoughts I think towards you, says the Lord, and it's thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. So if God's thoughts are not our thoughts, if God's thoughts are good towards us, and you're thinking negative thoughts, then whose plan are you following for your life? See, a lot of times it's not what's happening to us that causes us to suffer. It's what we think is happening to us. That is the reality. So step number one is that in order to fail, you got to at least try to do something. And step number two is you got to change your thinking. Because if you change your thinking, you can change your circumstances. See, we should think like this. If I fall, please let me fall on my back so that at least I can look up. I'm not even going to focus on how I fail, but I'm going to focus on how I'm going to get back up. See, we should think, my marriage didn't fail. I just got another opportunity to try it again with more wisdom and intelligence next time. You shouldn't think, my bank account is empty. You should think, my bank account is not empty. It's just waiting for me to make wiser financial decisions to fill it up with. See, step number three is becoming a big failure. You have to learn from your mistakes. During an interview with a sports broadcaster, this athlete expressed his thoughts on failure. He said, I missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. 26 times I was trusted to take the game-winning shot, and I missed. I failed over and over and over again in my life, and that is why I succeed. That was Michael Jordan. In another famous interview, this very powerful woman shared her story about failure. She said, when I was 14 years old and pregnant, I hid my pregnancy for 7 months. When my mother found out that I was pregnant, she took me to a girls' detention home. As I was sitting in the girls' detention home, I looked around at all the girls that had been placed there for being bad girls. And I thought to myself, I am now officially a bad girl. I was thinking to myself as I was sitting there waiting for my name to be called that I really didn't belong there and that I didn't know how this happened to me. See, I had been raped and molested ever since I was 9 years old. As I sat there thinking that I didn't belong there, a woman came out and spoke to me and my mother, and she said, I'm sorry, Miss Lee, but there is not enough room on our docket for your daughter. You'll have to come back in 2 weeks. There isn't enough room for her. My mother and I had to leave, and I was sent to live with my father, and that was my saving grace. At 14 years old, I gave birth, and the baby died. When the baby died, my mother looked at me and said, my father looked at me and said, this is your second chance. This is your opportunity to seize the moment and make something out of your life. I took that moment as an opportunity to learn that when you know better, you should do better. That 14-year-old girl was Oprah Winfrey. So you see, the most successful people have had some big failures. Failures that shaped and molded them into the people that they are today. Moses, Michael Jordan, Oprah teach us that failure is not the opposite of success. Failure is a part of success. So if you are dreaming of doing anything in life, you have to be prepared that failure is a part of that program. Failure teaches you what not to do. Failure teaches you to change your mindset, to rethink your game plan. So as I was studying the concept of failure, I realized that most people categorize their opportunities in life to grow as failures. So I started asking different people in my life that are closest to me what the biggest failure has been so far in their life, and this is what they had to say. I called my father. His name is Andre Edison McNeil. He's 68 years old. He said, my biggest failure in life has been in my relationship with your mother. They've been divorced now for over 20 years. He said, my biggest failure in life was thinking that what the world had to offer me was greater than what I had at home. He said, I was a world traveler. I was an avid reader. I sought new experiences. Your mother was simple. She was loyal. She was reliable. She was trustworthy. She just wanted to love me and be a good wife. And that wasn't enough for me. I asked my husband. Now, my husband does not like to know what I'm going to talk about when I minister. He likes to hear it for the first time. So, but he did allow me to ask him this question. I said, you know, honey, can you tell me what the biggest failure has been in your life up to this point? And for those of you who don't know, my husband's name is Willie Mullins. He's 52. And he said, my biggest failure has been in finances because my biggest failure in life was not paying attention to life's experiences. I said, well, why is that? He said, well, it was like I was driving a car, but I wasn't reading the street signs. See, if you know my husband, he's very astute with finances. Like, we literally know where every penny is. So when I asked him about this, he was telling me, he said, what keeps you going, honey? He said, well, God and I have a trampoline mentality. I said, what's a trampoline mentality? He said, well, trampoline mentality says that no matter how long I'm down, at some point I'm going to bounce back up. He said, Now, my husband, if you know him, he's a quiet person, so he was feeling this thing. So he gives me an illustration, and he says, have you ever been on a trampoline? I said, yes, I have. He said, you know, when you're in a trampoline, you're jumping. If you want to stop, you got to bend your knees. And he said, when you bend your knees, he said, that's prayer. And he said, and if you want to push yourself up again, you have to use your arms and push yourself up. I said, and that's praise. He said, yeah, but don't just stay there in prayer. You got to put work with it, too. So talking to him, he was able to expound on that and help me to realize that you can't just bend your knees in prayer to get yourself back up, but you also have to use your hand in praise. See, whatever it is in life, just don't quit. If it's your alcoholic spouse, don't quit. Your deadbeat dad, don't quit. If it's your lying wife, don't quit. Because Jeremiah 8:4 says, you know if a man falls down, he gets back up again. And if a man goes the wrong way, he turns around and comes back. Proverbs 24:16 says, the righteous man falls 7 times, but still gets up. 2 Corinthians 4:9 says, we are persecuted, but God does not leave us. We are hurt sometimes, but we are not destroyed. And Micah 7:8 says, our enemies have no reason to gloat over us. We have fallen, but we will rise again. We are in darkness now, but the Lord will give us light. I want you to be encouraged. Pastor Ravel said something on Sunday that really blessed me. He said, someone is going to see you in a low place and still see you as a good investment. It is not over until God says it's over. I want every one of you to leave here tonight with a new mindset, including me, that it doesn't matter how tired you are, how overwhelmed you are, in due time, if you just keep going, you will reap a reward. All you have to do is keep going. With the kingdom mindset, you are never becoming a failure. Everything is happening for you. Nothing is happening to you. Don't focus on what you wish you had. Praise God for what you have right now. Don't just drive your car. Read the road signs. And remember, keep the faith. God is working it out for your good.
Amen, amen. Go ahead and put your hands together again for the men and women of God that have brought forth a mighty word tonight. Amen. Now, if y'all know me, y'all know I'm an analytical person, so I got to tie all that together for myself. So I'm going to read you what I wrote down, trying to piece this together. It might help you tonight. We're going all the way back to Minister Richard Lee. Just says, your suspicion of God will make you leave your place of grace and cleave unto the world. It puts us in a position where it's difficult to conform to the will of God because we won't repent. It's in those times where we are disobedient that we become a big failure, which the world says is a jacked up place to be. But as a believer, we should dance through the fire of failure and tell the doubters, look at me now. Yeah. Amen. So, you know, I had to piece that all together for myself. So, yeah, that was good. But thank God for the men and the women of God that have come forth. You know, definitely a right now word for somebody in the house. So thank you guys for staying in the will of God, staying in the word of God to be ready when the time came to deliver a word to the house. Definitely want to recognize anybody that may be a guest with us in here tonight. If you're a first time guest tonight, throw your hands in there. Just wave at me one time. Okay, I see a few hands. First time guests. All right. Welcome, welcome, definitely. On behalf of Pastor Mo and Pastor Case, we welcome you to the well on tonight. After we depart, we have a fusion room right to the back over here. If there's any, okay, Rashida's over there with guest services. If you would follow her to the fusion room, we'd definitely like to greet you. Our pastoral staff will come back there and greet you before you head out tonight. Those of you women, I know you already know, we have the shoe drive going on to raise money and awareness for our transitional house. So we thank those that have already brought the shoes in. If you have not, you don't know what it is, we have a table out front. You can stop by, figure out what it is, how you can get involved, how you can help us reach our goal to really bless and make a difference over at that transitional house through collecting shoes. We're not asking for your money. We just want your shoes. New and gently used. Don't bring us something falling apart, something you wouldn't wear. New and gently used shoes. We're definitely collecting those for the next 90 days, but we want to get them in as quickly as we can so we can get those proceeds to go toward the transitional house. Amen? So we're going to all do our part and bring in some shoes to help that transitional house. Amen? All right, well, go ahead and stand on your feet. We're about to go home on the night. Men of God. We do have men's prayer this coming Saturday. If you did not receive an email from us, see me before you leave so I can get your email address. We can keep you in the loop of what's going on. Men's prayer right here at 7 a.m. Saturday morning. There was a change on there. We said we would do breakfast at Golden Corral. However, one of the men, partners of the house, Tracy Talford, he's got a boat that he's going to meet us out at Ebenezer Park right after men's prayer, right at about 8 o'clock. We'll transition and head over there, get on the boat, go across the lake. They got a little island out there, and we're just going to barbecue, throw some things on the grill, hang out. So if you got some time on Saturday to hang out with some of the fellas, we definitely would love for you guys to connect with us on Saturday. Amen. Amen. Well, it's time to go. Father, we thank you right now for the word that has come forth. We thank you for those that have spoken into the lives of your people. We thank you for the vision of this house. Our pastors, Maurice and Katiti Revelle, Lord, keep them covered under the grace, Father God, that they may continue to lead us in the will of God, Father. Right now, I bless your people in their coming and their going. Bless them that they shall continue to prosper, that everything they touch shall be blessed, Father God. Their family shall be blessed. Those on their job shall be blessed beyond belief, Father, that they may come to know you for who you really are. In Jesus' name, we thank you for traveling mercies as we leave this place, but never your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you are dismissed.